This week, gold and silver flew higher, as well as the NASDAQ, which recorded a new record weekly bull market close following dovish comments from the FOMC. Welcome back, everybody. Great to be with you on another Muy Grande Size Show. Your host, Chris Waltzek, here with a rare triple header of guests. Debt. It's truly becoming a four-letter word these days. After the 2007 foreclosure crisis, tens of millions of us here in this country learned all too well the lessons offered by one of our great American thinkers, neither a borrower nor a lender be. Well, that's easier said than done. Try to have a life without some debt of some kind. So how much debt is acceptable? The typical rule of thumb for a mortgage is 3 times household income, so $50,000 combined, and a $150,000 house is probably okay. But what if the same family tries to buy a $600,000 house? Well, our first guest thinks this is precisely what our officials have done to each and every one of us. We're all on the hook now for the government profligacy, says the first batter out of the box, Professor Lawrence Kotlikoff. He recently appeared before the U.S. Senate, warning our representatives that the national debt is 12 times our annual GDP when you include unfunded liabilities. That's about $210 trillion with a capital T. The future he sees is hyperinflation, where money is worthless. Don't expect it next week, next month, or even next year, but that's what he's looking for. Next at the plate, Peter Granditch swings a heavy bat. He's convinced that gold is the investment du jour, priced well below its intrinsic value. Still, he's a portfolio and diversification convert, hedging his bets. He recognizes that it only takes one bad time at the plate, or trade, to ruin an account. And what's that saying? What's the fastest way to make $1 million? Start trading with $1 billion. And batting cleanup, Charles Hughes Smith from Of Two Minds makes his debut here. He brings all the runners across home plate. He's concerned that most markets are nearing bubble-like conditions, making investing as challenging as ever, despite the bevy of options available to every investor. And we'd like for you to record your questions and comments on our new toll-free hotline 24/7. I have to make a small mea culpa here to our recent callers. In the last few weeks, we just moved to a new studio location, and I accidentally deleted your calls. We'd love for you to please deign to call back and share your thoughts and wisdom with us here on the show. Next time, our hotline is 206-66-65-370. Again, 206-66-65-5370. We want to hear from you, and it's not toll-free, though. GoldSeek.com radio begins now with a market recap. Partly sunny skies appeared over the New York COMEX exchange this week. Gold added 19, finishing in right around $1,200, a very positive technical condition. Silver added 12 cents, ending over $16 an ounce. The XAU gold and silver's equities ended near the break-even point around $66.65, while West Texas Intermediate crude also finished near that break-even point around $60 a barrel. Still looking good, though, in the charts. Gold recorded the best weekly performance in a month after Fed Chair Yellen and colleagues announced on Wednesday that the longer-term outlook for U.S. rates was more dovish. The Federal Reserve Chair indicated slower interest rate increases in the safe haven asset. Holdings in exchange-traded products backed by the metal rose for a second day on Wednesday, the first consecutive advance in a month. 7 of the 17 policymakers expect a single rate hike this year, indicating a bit of dissension among the crowd. Officials reiterated comments that rate hikes would take place only after the labor market improves and their inflation target is met of around 2%. Interestingly, policymakers did lower their target, though, for the benchmark rate from around 2% to 1.6% at the end of 2016, and around 3.1%, they dropped it to 2.9% in 2017, right in the region of 3.75%, and that's a long way from where we are right now. Furthermore, comments from the FOMC indicated a key date for interest rate hikes, and this is a shift in guidance away from that extended period Fed speak we've heard in recent meetings. Former Federal Reserve Governor Lyle Gramley noted that the economy is not as robust as earlier thought. The Fed has held the benchmark rate near zero, the lowest in national history for nearly 7 years, since December 2008, to stave off economic collapse. Economists expect the Federal Reserve, though, to stop increases after no more than 2 interest rate hikes. However, one has to wonder just how they're going to get there, because a half rate hike is probably all we'll see with those 2 rate hikes in total. So how do we get to a 3.75% target by 2017? And the statement after the 2-day meeting indicated that Dr. Yellen and company refused to give perfect guidance to investors, and that makes sense. They're not going to show us their hand sitting at the poker table. And turning to news in the European Union, Athens and its creditors are caught at an impasse, increasing gold's appeal sharply over the Greek debt drama, which ratcheted up a bit this week. Analysts now expect officials to sell some of their gold stockpile, national gold stockpile, to postpone default. The total government gold supply is valued at over $4 billion. Eurozone leaders will hold a summit on Monday to try and stem the Greek default. Still, bank runs are plaguing the nation, with nearly $500 million withdrawn in a single day this week and about $1 billion in a single day the week before. Some are saying that it's accelerating, but to me it just seems not so good. A meeting of Eurozone leaders is viewed as a final step on Monday for this Greek bailout. The European Council President Donald Tusk referred to it as an emergency meeting. Precious metals, bottom line. Well, it's a constructive week for gold and silver. That's good. The U.S. dollar plummet also continued. That's positive. I continue to like the precious metals sector as the ideal portfolio safety net for non-speculative investors. Moving on to the Wall Street Report, partly sunny weather appeared over the New York Stock Exchange for the second week running as investors turned to equities on dollar weakness. The Dow Jones Industrials Average ended at 18.015, up 117 for the week. The S&P 500 ended at 21.10, up 16 points, and the NASDAQ ended at 66, a new record weekly close in this ongoing bull market, over 5,100. Very, very close to the 2000 peak we saw 15 years ago. Moving on, in domestic economic news, U.S. economic data, consumer price index saw its biggest gain in more than 2 years, but was still lower than economists had expected. Weekly jobless claims fell to 267,000, holding ground near a 15-year low. Solid economic numbers this week reassured equities investors that the economy is on track. A solid employment report indicates more people are working than expected. In equities news, Jana Partners disclosed a 7% stake in ConAgra Foods and plans to change the board of directors. ConAgra shares blasted higher, about 11%. Bottom line on Wall Street. Well, investor fear levels increased sharply for the second week running, as viewed in the 7-indicator sentiment index, and this suggests that selling may be reaching capitulation levels. The combination of dovish Fed and solid economic numbers could provide a floor in the next few weeks, and I like the NASDAQ at bull market highs. A few signs of accumulation, so buyer beware. Coming up after the break, more Gold Seek Radio. We'd like for you to stay with us right here. Today's special guest, Professor of Economics at Boston University, Dr. Lawrence Kotlikoff, author of The Inform Act. Well, it's a pleasure and an honor to have Dr. Lawrence Kotlikoff, a professor of economics, author of The Clash of the Generations, as well as The Inform Act, the Intergenerational Financial Obligations Reform Act, focused on improving the welfare of every American. Welcome back, Professor Kotlikoff.
My pleasure. Back with you.
Thank you, sir. I'd like to begin the discussion today with your recent comments before the U.S. Senate on the U.S. budget. You know, we hear of Greece and its struggle here with debt, and a default appears imminent. Negotiations broke down over the weekend. We don't hear a lot of talk, though, by our officials, at least not in the mainline press, regarding our debt situation. And when you delve into the numbers and look at the minutiae, it sounds less than sanguine, to put it euphemistically. Tell us what you told the Senate and what's keeping you up at night.
Well, I told the senators that our country is broke. We're not broke 50 years from now or 30 years from now or 10 years from now we're broke today. We have a fiscal gap, a gap separating the value in the present of all future projected expenditures, net of all future projected taxes, which is $210 trillion large. That's based on CBO's, the Congressional Budget Office's projection. So, and this is a methodology looking, putting everything on the books, looking long-term at the, actually at the infinite horizon, but discounting, making, taking the value in the present of things way out in the future that are projected and obviously uncertain, but because they're way out in the future, their increment to the fiscal gap is relatively small, but they can't be ignored because otherwise you're kind of ending up with a measure of our fiscal obligations that's leaving something out of the picture. So, and is very subject to language manipulation. So, economists as a group believe that this is the way to do the accounting correctly. There's the informact.org is a website where you'll see over 1,200 economists have endorsed this kind of accounting, and that includes 17 Nobel Prize winners. So if you look at the fiscal gap, it's $210 trillion. That's 58% of the present value of revenue that's projected. So that means we need an immediate and permanent 58% tax hike. Every single federal tax, you name it, the FICA tax, the federal income tax, the federal excise taxes, federal corporate taxes, estate and gift taxes, that entire stream or path of tax revenues that's being projected by the CBO, the Congressional Budget Office, needs to be 58% higher to pay for all the expenditures we have planned to do, according to the CBO's projection. So the country is in far worse fiscal shape than Detroit was before it declared bankruptcy. They were about 20% underfinanced. The entire country is 58% underfinanced. Illinois' pension funds are about 60% underfinanced, just to give you a comparison. So, we're not in as bad a shape as perhaps Russia or perhaps Greece, but we're in terrible shape and far worse shape than most developed countries. And this is not going to, and nobody's paying any attention, nobody in the political sphere here. Is really talking about this. With one exception, Dr. Carson, Ben Carson, who's running for president, mentioned these numbers, and it was immediately criticized as coming up with phony numbers. But I wrote a column defending him. I know nothing really about Dr. Carson's positions on anything. I'm not a supporter necessarily, but I think he was telling the truth about our fiscal situation.
You talk about a $210 trillion gap, and let's assume we make, I don't know, as a year GDP, $17 trillion. Back of the envelope math, we owe 12 times. Just to give some context, a household typically can borrow 3 years of total income on a mortgage. We would owe 12 times just to take out that same mortgage. You'd have to default, or you'd have to come up, as you say, with ridiculously high taxes that no politician would agree to. So I think you make a great point, but we won't linger on this. You also go on to say that this could lead to a collapse. And we've heard a lot about imminent crises over the years. People get numb to the idea because they're just trying to get through the day-to-day grind. If we don't take steps now, we could find ourselves in a quagmire. And I think it's interesting because we had a guest a few weeks ago, Mr. Embry from Canada, who pointed out it's much better to be a year or two early when it comes to preparations than even an hour too late. Are you afraid that most Americans could be too late in their preparations for what's coming?
Yeah, there could be very high inflation because the government's been printing money at a high rate since 2007. This is what you see in countries that are broke. They print money because they can't politically cut spending enough or raise taxes enough. Either economically or politically, there's only so much taxation you can impose on a population before they start leaving the country. So there are some limits. And the easy thing for the politicians to do is put pressure on the central bank to print money. And if the central bankers want to be, anticipate that or think through what's going to be happening, they can just you know, basically take their directions from the fact that Congress is not paying its bills, and they could just start printing money on their own. So I think that's what you saw with Ben Bernanke, that he was observing the fact that the government wasn't covering its obligations, and he thought, well, let's print money, and maybe we can keep interest rates low in the process and not really let people understand how much money is being created and how much this could lead to inflation. So he's increased the base money supply, which is called the monetary base, by a factor of about four since 2007. So he's laid the basis for a fourfold increase in the price level for hyperinflation. And I don't know when that could happen. It may never happen, but people like Milton Friedman, who were concerned about using just printing money to pay for the government's bills, would be, you know, Milton Friedman were alive today, he would be screaming the top of his lungs over this. So I'm concerned about it. There are a lot of reasons why the inflation rate hasn't gone up yet, but it's there's a lot of money sloshing around, and potentially sloshing around, a lot of money sitting in reserves in the banks that could be let loose into the economic bloodstream. So anyway, that's what we're doing. We're running on empty. We're printing money. We're not investing in infrastructure. We have been engaged in a Ponzi scheme. The reason we've got all this huge fiscal gap is that we put all these obligations to the baby boomers for Medicare, Medicaid, and Social Security off the books. We have huge defense obligations going forward, just general spending, and we're not investing in the country. So the whole thing is a total mess, and we need some real leadership that's apolitical, because these politicians are taking the country down and our children down with it.
I do believe that Dr. Friedman and all of the folks who followed in his footsteps would concur with you that it's economic suicide.
I think 1,200 economists, including 17 Nobel Prize winners, have sounded the alarm. If you go to the informact.org, you'll see endorsements of the fiscal gap, and they understand that the fiscal gap is absolutely enormous, horrendous. So the economics profession has spoken very clearly. The fact that the politicians and the press aren't paying any attention is not, you know, we've done what we can do as economists, and these are mostly academic economists, and these are people from the right and the left politically, in terms of their, some people are obviously, not everybody's on the right or the left, but you have economists who lean right, very far right, you have economists who lean very far left, but what they're saying is, economic science is not up for grabs. There's a way to measure our long-term fiscal problem situation, and this is it. And they understand how big the problem is. So it's not that one or two economists agree with me. There may be very few people that are speaking out publicly to the extent I am or the pitch I am, but the vast majority of economists who understand what our science has to offer are endorsing the Inform Act. And to get 17 Nobel Prize winners to endorse any piece of legislation is essentially impossible. And this is what happened. You've got that number. That's almost all the American Nobel Prize winners in economics have endorsed this bill. It would require, let me just be clear what the bill would do. It would require the government to start doing fiscal gap accounting on a routine basis. It requires the CBO, the GAO, and the OMB all to do fiscal gap accounting. And so far these agencies have refused to do that. So they're saying they know more than the entire economics profession. Well, shame on them. I think it's a disgrace that they're just ignoring the top economists from Harvard, MIT, Chicago, Yale, Stanford, Princeton, Penn, you name it, are on that list. Every top, it's a who's who of economists. And people like George Shultz are on this list, former Secretary of Treasury. So, yeah, we have big problems, but they're just getting worse because nobody's paying any attention. And I don't think any of the other, there's something like 25 presidential candidates, maybe one, again, Ben Carson has mentioned it, But that's it.
I think it was very eloquently said. And hat tip to you and all of your colleagues for the fine work you've done. I have a feeling that people will turn to the Inform Act as soon as the economy rolls over in earnest, as I think you would agree is inevitable at some point. And, of course, the stock market, which tends to be the barometer that seems to have the most eyeballs on it, at least in the general public. You brought up a really key statistic. If we look at the St. Louis Fed's, the monetary base, 2009, it's been parabolic, and it is a fourfold increase, and there really is no signs of that rolling over. That's not to say they couldn't curtail QE operations. Talking about raising rates, do you think that this threat, if you will, of higher rates, could they be serious about cooling off the economy?
I think interest rates are going to go up. I think they're unnaturally low. And, there's major damage to certain people that are on fixed incomes and trying to get some return on their investments. So the elderly population has been suffering for years now from these low interest rates. I think that Janet Yellen has decided to stop printing money at the rate that Ben Bernanke was printing it, and that if rates have to go up because of that, where rates are, it's pretty much the Fed has some control over short-term rates, but it doesn't necessarily have control over 30-year rates. And the 30-year rates are being determined in the market based on expectations of inflation. If enough people understand how broke the country is, they're going to stay miles away from any long-term bonds that are nominal, that are not inflation-indexed, which means inflation rates, interest prices of bonds will go down, and interest rates will go up, and then money will become more of a hot potato because people realize that the longer they hold money, the more interest they're losing. And then you have this massive addition to the money supply. More of it will come out of the banks' reserves into the bloodstream, be lent out, and then you will have it being moving around more rapidly. So you'll have faster money being effectively like more money. And then you'll have inflation take off. Well, that's a scenario that can arise here almost overnight. By overnight, I don't mean in one day. I mean maybe over a couple of years. But we've seen this time and again from the look at the hyperinflation in the year 300 under Diocletian, the Roman emperor. This is a tried and true formula for disaster when you print money out the wazoo. And that's what the government's been doing here in our country. And I say government, it's the Federal Reserve, but the Federal Reserve is in cahoots with the rest of Congress and the Treasury, easing the burden, this whole notion of quantitative easing, it's easing the burden on Congress to do its job and on the president to do his job to balance the books. And it's not just keeping the deficit low, because the deficit is really a meaningless number. It's really the fiscal gap, because, again, most of the obligations and the increase in the obligations are off the books. So your Social Security benefits, for example, aren't part of federal debt, but they're a real obligation. Somebody's got to pay for them. And we're leaving these bills basically to our kids. That's immoral. Every time we talk, the situation doesn't look any better. This is a credit card bill, $210 trillion credit card bill that keeps growing with interest. It doesn't get smaller. It doesn't just sit there. It's not a bill that we have to pay in the future. It's a bill that if we don't pay, gets bigger. And the fiscal gap grew by $5 trillion over the last year. The official deficit was, the increase in the official debt was maybe $300, $400 billion.
From our perspective, you are a hero, because you have taken an unpopular stance that many officials do not want to hear, and that is, folks, you need to curtail your spending. You can't have the power extended without some oversight here, and things are getting out of control, and you've sort of stuck your neck out with many of your fine colleagues. Thank you, sir.
My pleasure. Okay. You take care. Bye-bye.
Well, thanks for choosing GoldSeek.com Radio. Today's featured guest, Peter Grandich from PeterGrandich.com. Peter Grandich of Peter Grandich and Company, with over 30 years on Wall Street as an advisor and analyst. It's a pleasure to have him back on the show. Hello, sir.
Good to be be back, Chris.
From the beginning of the year, you talked about having an epiphany, if you will, this idea that perhaps it's best to keep the bulk of our wealth in a solid portfolio with diversification so that we can participate in that free lunch that Dr. Markowitz talked about and earned the Nobel Prize. Give us an idea of some of the strides you've taken there to protect your family and maybe even some of your clients or friends.
Sure. After, like you said, over 3 decades of believing I could, on a regular basis, time the market, I concluded that while there have been good periods when I was able to do that, there's also been periods when I greatly underperformed the market. And then when I looked at statistics of almost 80% of money managers unable to match the performance of a simple index fund, I concluded that while there were times when I could be among the 20%, when I wasn't among the 20%, I did very bad. So I made a choice to not only get out of the soothsayer business, but to also use, for the most part, low-cost index funds. And for some people, I still believe active money management is appropriate, but by and large, for the public, index funding is a better way.
I mean, how many people really timed the exact market in bottom 2009? I mean, people even to this day, the bulk of folks say 2008, 2009 was just too difficult. I just watched my portfolio crater. But, you know, fast forward 6-7 years later and the bull market is strongly underway. It's in your best interest. Why don't you give us an idea, though, of what you see in the mining sector? I mean, that's been your forte. Are you still following the, precious metals, juniors and whatnot?
You've done something for almost 30 years. You can make it a complete void. I may not watch it, but I certainly follow the metals themselves still closely. And, obviously with that, I look at the mining shares. I still have a significant part of my speculative money in a couple of plays. So I find it very interesting, Chris, that here we are almost halfway to 2015. We saw another story in recent days now that they're investigating the rigging possibly of treasury markets. We know they've done it in the interest rate market. We know they've been found guilty in the foreign currency market. We've known what's happened in the general equity and bond market for years. And yet the people make fun of those who suggest that there's manipulation in the gold and silver market. Now, isn't that silly of those people, after all these markets, other markets have been demonstrated to be, that somehow think that at the wall and the door of the COMEX, the rigging stops? I mean, I just think maybe we'll never see the smoking gun in our lifetime. But those of us who have argued that there has been manipulation and a suppressing of the gold and silver market, I think the evidence, circumstantial evidence, is certainly enough to feel victorious. Having said that, it certainly hasn't been victorious in price movement in the last few years. But I think it's whatever as America has taken away from its future from barring the way, by forestalling and suppressing the metals to a much lower level where they would be otherwise, whatever leads to the eventual breakout from that, because no market can forever stay manipulated. I know people have heard for years, but I will tell you, nothing in history has ever been able to, no matter what the cartels, no matter who was doing it, eventually something gives way. And in this particular case, I think when it gives way, it's going to give way to a very long, sustainable market. In fact, it was just a couple weeks ago when an article circulated by a gentleman who would not be considered a gold bug or among who talked about an Elliott Wave theory basis, a $25,000 gold price. And I'll just add to that, being long-winded here to you, that I can recall when I entered the brokerage business in 1984, the stock market had basically traded between 700 and 1,000 on the Dow for almost 30 years. And a guy came along at the time, not known, from a little town in Gainesville, Georgia, named Robert Prechter, and who claimed by something very absurd that no one knew, the Elliott Wave theory, that the Dow was going to hit 3,700. And I can remember people literally laughing and saying, how could that possibly be? So 25,000, yeah, it's a crazy number, and you'd have to think things would turn pretty bad. But I certainly think gold and silver, worst days are behind us. This long sideways contraction after a bear market is actually bullish for much higher long-term prices. And there's going to be something happens fundamentally that's going to give it the light that it needs.
You know, the Greek debt showdown is starting to intensify. According to some media reports, the banking system is in jeopardy. We're hearing about bank runs on a wide scale basis. Just on Thursday alone, they lost $700 million. On Friday, over $1 billion in just over 24 hours from a tiny banking sector. Clearly, they're delaying their payments to the International Monetary Fund. Nobody likes to hear this. It doesn't do anybody any good. It's hard on the markets. It's hard on the folks, especially in the country. And it's also straining the Euro Union. Give us an idea of the implications of this.
I think it can go down several different roads. My own personal opinion is we'll move out of the Euro. I mean, I believe it's way beyond repair. Why? They are not yet ready to bite the bullet, as seemingly more and more people within the union are. I think that's the inevitable, only clear-cut way to go. I mean, Greece is just 4% of the GDP of the whole Europe. It's not good. It's not great. But the question will be is, if and when that happens, how long before the market focuses on the next potential bad candidate in the union, whether it's Spain, some even think Italy, where there is a banking concern. So I think there would be a relief, actually, if they left after the first real initial negative. And then it will be dependent on how they massage the news, how they could keep the next troubled area coming apart. And they're not the only one. I think here in the United States, one of the reasons I believe the Fed is deathly afraid of raising interest rates, not just because of what it may do to the financial markets, that they know that we have not really recovered as much as the don't worry, be happy crowd would like to say. In the banking sector, we've gotten speculative again, whether it's car loans or riskier mortgage loans again, and of course how so much money has flowed into the junk bond market, and when the inevitable recession comes, how many corporations are not going to be able to honor their debt. Issues still all around the world, not just in Greece. It's just where people are focused at the moment.
So it's sort of the canary in the proverbial coal mine. It could be the wake-up call, the shot across the bow for the rest of us. Peter Grandage, we want to thank you for your time today. And for our listeners who are interested, they can find out more about your work, Peter Grandage and Company. The website is petergrandage.com. That's all one word, Peter Grandage.com. Thanks so much, Peter. Great to have you back with us at GoldSeek.com Radio. Today's featured guest, Charles Hughes Smith from Of Two Minds. We've got a special guest. It's just a pleasure to welcome Charles Hughes Smith of the blog Of Two Minds, and of course his 10th year anniversary. It covers a wide spectrum of topics, including housing, Asia, energy, all kinds of trends and themes throughout the market, social issues. He's written 7 must-read books of his own. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Chris. A little bit humbled by your description.
No, you shouldn't. I noticed lately health is a very important topic and issue that you've been concerned with. Many of our listeners, like myself, spend, it seems like, endless hours in front of a computer screen. It's not healthy. Recently, last 6 months, I've been every hour getting up, walking around minimum 5 or 10 minutes briskly. This is supposed to be a wonder cure, and it certainly had big impact on my life. Give us an idea of how health care is an issue impacting everybody.
Well, Chris, I applaud you for breaking up your sit-down time, and I try to do the same thing. I mean, recent studies have said sitting for many hours in a row is just really bad news for us. And, of course, the reason why is we weren't really developed as hunter-gatherers and, you know, small agricultural communities where we came from. Sitting down for hours on end in a chair was not something we did. So our comfort in our modern society is actually a health risk. And so I think my interest in health is both as a citizen, if you will, and it's as a consumer of health care. I'm self-employed, so my wife and I pay our own health care insurance costs. We make too much money to have it subsidized. We're not rich enough so that it doesn't count. It does count. It's $15,000 a year for 2 people. And so I think that's where I start from, is what kind of care are we getting for the amount of money that we spend? And we spend about twice as much per person in the U.S. as as our competitor nations like Japan, Germany, and the rest of Western Europe, our developed country competitors. And so you have to wonder, what are we doing wrong that we're spending twice as much money, but we're not twice as healthy? And, of course, it's a complicated topic, but in general, it's the same problem that all of our major industries have, which is if you get enough money, then you can buy political influence and protect your industry from competition and transparency. And that's healthcare all over it, right? We all know the billing system is really opaque. You can't figure out what the bill is. You know, we know that they bill Medicare huge amounts of money and then they settle for less, but it's still way more than it should be. So all these problems are facing us as individuals and also as a society, and the demographics are really running against us here because, I'm 61 and like there's 60 million of us baby boomers and we're entering the system here, which was designed for an older time when there was people didn't live as long and there was maybe 5 to 8 workers per retiree. Well, now it's going to be pushing 2 to 1. There'll only be 2 full-time workers for every retiree. And I don't think any system is sustainable at that that ratio.
I've enjoyed over the years your comments and commentary on the housing sector. 2007, 2008, we saw everything come unraveled at the seams. Since then, things have started to recover, at least on paper. I'd like your thoughts on whether or not you expect this echo bubble, as you call it, to persist, or if this is merely a blip on the radar screen.
Well, that's a great question, Chris, and a lot of us are wondering that ourselves. And it's hard to predict, but we can at least look at the fundamental dynamics here. One is the tremendous range in valuations we have here in the United States. Like, I have a reader in Columbus, Ohio, for Midwest, former industrialized, you know, area that's kind of coming to grips with that passing of that industrialized area. And some of the cities are doing very well, some less well. But in general, you can still buy a house there for, $60,000, or even if it's in a troubled area, $20,000, $6,000. I mean, you can buy a house or you can rent a house for $800, where here on the left coast in the urbanized California areas, no young person or young couple, even earning good salaries, can possibly afford an $800,000 2-bedroom, 1-bath bungalow. It's just ridiculous. And so the danger is we've priced out the younger generation entirely in these hyper-developed markets like, Greater New York, some of Miami, California, L.A., so on. And those are where the job growth and the salaries are strong. And so I think we're facing a social inequality issue here, that those of us who bought 20, 30 years ago, we've increased our wealth, at least on paper, where the young generation has been priced out. And so that's an issue that we avoid talking about because there's no easy solution to it. The other thing is, of course, we all know real estate's based on the interest rate that people pay for the mortgage and the relative attractiveness of it as an investment. And in a climate where, a 10-year bond is drawing 1.5% to 2% interest, then a lot of the big money rushed into rental housing because you could earn, 4 or 5%, basically double.
It's essentially free money, isn't it, to make an investment, and then you receive this hefty capital gains on housing, but then you also have the rental income.
It's a great point. So then the question becomes, as for those of us looking at this as a potential investment, how do you find that seam between a neighborhood or a city that is not attractive to young people or people that make enough money to rent the place you're buying because the job market's depressed and it's not as attractive as other places? The really attractive places, which are sky high, and you cannot possibly make money buying a rental in these cities where, units are going for $500,000 or $1 million. Even at $3,000 a month or $4,000 a month rent, you're still not making money. So where can you find that? And that's, of course, the million-dollar question for small investors is where can you go that you're not competing with Blackstone and hedge funds who are buying 10,000 houses at a time? And then we also have to look ahead and ask, what happens when interest rates go up?
This is the question that I feel that everyone is ignoring. They can't stay above board with regard to the interest rate specter. Got to buy a house now while interest rates are low. Yes, sure, you might get better terms on your 30-year ball and chain, but what happens when other folks who didn't purchase begin to realize, wait a minute, rates are going up and they might continue to go up for another 5-10 years, making real estate incredibly less affordable? This is the big question mark.
Well, Chris, you probably are better informed than I am about the global bond market, but you know, your listeners know by now that our economy is intimately connected to the global economy, right? And the recent increase in bond yields globally isn't more evidence of that, right? In other words, in Germany, in the U.S., it's like globally interest rates and yields seem to be rising despite the central bank's decision to keep them near zero. And so that's making people start questioning whether central banks absolutely can control this and keep interest rates, you know, near zero forever. And the answer appears to be apparently not. In other words, the bond market might push yields higher regardless of central bank policy because the buyers of bonds are sensing higher risk. They're sensing the potential for inflation. And whatever they're perceiving, it's pushing yields higher. So the Fed can do one thing, but mortgage rates can continue to go up. You know, over time, as you and I know, rates and yields tend to normalize, which is another way of just saying they go back to where they used to be over the past 30, 40 years. And so, you know, those of us who are a little older remember when a mortgage was 7 or 7.5 was a good rate. And so that would be practically double from current rates. And as you said, that would push prices down because fewer people can afford a 7% mortgage.
Just last night, I was adding about 30 references to my upcoming dissertation, and I noticed this one article, which received rave reviews within, you know, the field, pointed out exactly what you just said. They came to the conclusion that I think most of us understand intuitively, that interest rates and themes within the economy have a tendency to revert to the mean. The average day trader, you know, knows this, anyone who's looked at a chart, but what I found interesting is that they found statistical evidence via some rather complex constructs and models to back up this idea. If rates are going to rise, that's going to put some pressure on burgeoning home buyers. And you notice the current pool, if you will, of home buyers has dried up because when the good jobs evaporate, they don't feel confident in the future. Renting looks like the better alternative. So let's talk about the monetary base. You know, direct our browsers over to the St. Louis Fed, you notice there that the adjusted monetary base is at all-time record highs and, interestingly, close to an exponential increase. At the precise bottom, is this a coincidence or is QE somehow correlated with this supposed economic recovery slash miracle?
Well, I think you know the answer, and you've probably explained it to listeners many, many times, and clearly the answer is yes. I tend to look at this question about monetary base, overall credit, which has also soared, as part of a process I call financialization. And it's not just me, other people use the word. And what that means is when you start pursuing a bunch of economic activity that doesn't create any new goods and services in the real economy, you're not really creating value. What you're doing is you're using leverage and credit to extract profits from something that used to just be a standard business. And, you know, mortgages is a good example, right? That used to be a very dull, boring business. A bank would issue a mortgage at a low interest rate and hold it for 30 years and so on. And now it's been tranched. You know, it's been sold as a security. It's had derivatives piled on top of it. And so that's why the subprime mortgage, which was industry, which was a pretty thin slice of the total mortgage business in the U.S., the collapse of that little thin slice was enough to bring down the whole global financial system because they'd loaded a tremendous amount of debt and leverage up on top of that. So that's the process of financialization, putting a bunch of extra paper money, a bunch of credit, a bunch of leverage on top of a base of actual assets, which has not grown at all.
At their own web page, one starts to, I think, notice some severe issues developing. We're starting to see money growth at exponential levels. And I think throughout time, and we look at history as our playbook, if you will, this just doesn't end well. It doesn't bode well for our economy, for society. I mean, because all the ills that tend to stem from this type of activity. Okay, we've covered that as well. Anything that I failed to bring up, presume you're watching the equities market with a weary eye like many of us here?
Yeah, Chris, wondering what will change this sort of chop, if you will, where every time the market declines 1%, then Greece is saved, China's saved, something is saved, and then the market recovers. But it doesn't really recover in a healthy fashion. You know, that breadth is still declining, volume is very poor. So in other words, all the signs that we look for in a healthy bull market are missing, and yet price is sort of maintaining its high levels. And that's what sparks fear in those of a couple of decades of looking at markets, is when those fundamentals of, like, breadth and volume are missing, we feel that's not a healthy market, despite the apparent ability of the market to keep recovering its previous highs.
Any other markets you're following or topicality?
Shall we talk about alternatives for what investors who are just trying to either maintain their nest egg or even grow their grow their retirement fund? To me, it's almost an impossible challenge at this point in time, because everything that has been recommended by the traditional, conventional financial analysts, stocks, bonds, and real estate, they're all at bubble valuations, if you will, based, as you say, on the historical playbook. It's very difficult to make money in any of these fields, because they've already, valuations have been pushed to the moon in terms of price earnings or however you want to value the yield on your investment. And so a lot of people are looking at precious metals, which we know have been beaten up. They're limited in what they can buy, you know, where they have IRAs or they have 401ks, and they can buy a gold or precious metals fund, but they're limited in how much they can buy. So it's a very tough environment, and that's partly why I kind of wonder if it isn't an era in which it's okay to just have cash, knowing that your yield is low. But you're waiting for, you have cash in hand when opportunities do arise. And if we know anything, they do arise. From overvalued becomes undervalued.
You know, that stockpile under the mattress certainly worked out well for Americans in 2009, 10, 11. I mean, following the implosion that started arguably late 2007, 2008, picking up houses at a third, a quarter, a half, just a year or two before. So maybe deflation is something to watch for. You're certainly echoing the sentiments of many of our guests here, given that having cash on hand can prove very handy when every market implodes. You know, just last week, we saw virtually every market decline. We haven't seen this in many, many years. Charles Hughes Smith, please tell people more about Of Two Minds and give them an idea about your books you've penned and any other topicality you'd like to share.
Well, I'd welcome everyone to come to of2minds.com. Check out my latest book, which is called Get a Job, Build a Real Career, and Defy a Bewildering Economy, which is written for the new economy. In other words, not the old traditional stuff where you get a college degree and then you're going to get a great middle-class job. We know that world's gone, and so you've got to learn different kinds of skills and take a different approach, and that's kind of my topic. Solve problems, use innovation and to solve problems, because we can't just go back and think it's going to return to the good old days. It's not. That's not the way history works.
I think that's so well said, because it's a new paradigm, and we have entered, you know, this new era where folks are changing jobs every couple of years. There's very little stability in the workplace, and this idea of, an entrepreneurial flair, even if you are trying to take a traditional course to employment, keeping expenses low, thinking about victory gardens, maybe having a vacation in your local area instead of a tropical resort. Not that we don't want to all go fly to Hawaii, but is that in your best interest long term? I want to encourage everyone to navigate their browsers to Of Two Minds. You'll find links on the webpage here, in our emails, and on Google search if you want to try it. We want to have you back on the show.
Thank you very much, Chris. Looking forward to it.
Thank you. Hey, Chris, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. A good friend of ours has been weighing the options of what to do with their home. They've ultimately decided to sell and downsize, but through this recent process have explored a variety of options, including a loan modification to their existing loan, presumably to reduce the burden of their monthly payments. I've had the opportunity to look at this process firsthand. The loan is with a major U.S. bank, and the process for inquiring about a loan modification, followed by the voluminous amount of paperwork that is required for submission, is complicated, time-consuming, and demanding. The documentation list is written in a very non-user-friendly fashion. The bank has sent no less than 3 packets of identical information and form letters from 3 different customer service executives, each about a week apart. Just as someone might be getting started preparing a modification documentation package that would rival any comprehensive tax return, another letter from the bank comes in the mail. Very confusing by any standard. It's almost as if the request got inserted into someone's loan modification follow-up software program. And now, for compliance purposes, the system is spitting out multiple packages to the same mortgage holder. I read through the requested documentation. It is extremely complicated by anyone's standards. That's a round one filtering mechanism in and of itself. And that's by design. Because people will simply look at the level of detail and forget about it or choose another option. Or they will proceed, and because of the complexity, it will be easy to deny the application because of missing or incomplete information. But this documentation is so complicated and so subjective in parts, I believe a homeowner could submit perfect documentation. And because of the complexity, the bank itself will likely make mistakes and deny the modification not because of homeowner error, but because of bank error. I watched numerous YouTube videos of consumers who had submitted and resubmitted their loan modification documents and made their trial payments only to get shafted at the end through a maze of miscommunication and last-minute changes from banks who literally have turned consumers' lives upside down. Our friend was just exploring the possibility of a modification and received 3 requests for documentation from 3 different customer service executives. Imagine how daunting that would be if you had decided to proceed with the loan modification process and gone through the pain and anguish of assembling the required paperwork, only to have it re-requested out of the blue for no reason from someone else at the bank at some point in the process. I watch these stories play out over and over again on YouTube, and then saw firsthand what has happened simply by requesting information on the process. I know for some, loan modifications have been a good thing. However, the complexity and uncertainty when a person is at their most vulnerable financially is a despicable form of financial and psychological abuse. Our friend who was looking into this told me this particular bank has a protocol for new hires. Managers are required to get a chest x-ray, and if the x-ray shows they have no heart, they get the job. I'm not sure if it's that bad everywhere. But I'm glad our friend is making other proactive plans that don't involve the bank. Chris, I'd like to urge all of our GoldSeek listeners to sign up for my email list at conquerchange.com. And if any of our listeners are ever involved in bringing in keynote speakers for their companies or professional organizations, please visit my companion website at robertian.com, which features a brand new video. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with conquerchange.com, reminding you to follow us on Twitter at conquerchange. Thanks, Chris.